Straw purchases reach the Supreme Court, new concerns over bird flu, and what's really going on with the stock market? Hey guys, it's February 5th, 2014. I'm Reginald. Welcome to the Dim Cat Channel. First, there's some concerns about bird flu. Bird flu because there's a new strain that killed a 73-year-old woman in China. Another person's been infected. They were concerned because she went to a live poultry market. And they're concerned because this strain has genetic characteristics that make it more efficient in moving from human to human. Now, the real key is whether the strain is going to mutate to the point where it's going to be able to be transmitted from human to human. That hasn't happened yet, but this is definitely something I'm going to keep my eye on. Other news stories. A Danish amputee was actually able to basically feel something with a bionic hand, a bionic arm. They actually had a surgery and they connected this arm to his nerves. And the guy was actually able to grab hard objects and tell that the object was hard. He was actually able to grab soft objects and tell that this object was soft. The guy was actually able to identify different shapes, which is pretty incredible. Really good news for people all across the world. This guy actually described it as amazing. So I'm hoping this is going to be the beginning of something positive for people who have lost limbs all across the world. Hopefully they can develop something that's cost effective and very efficient and reliable. They actually had scientists from Italy, Switzerland, and Germany involved in this. So very exciting. Okay, SyncNet, a web browser that can actually get across a lot of censorship. A lot of governments have certain type of blocks on certain websites. This is what you can't go here, you can't go there. Well, this Harvard research fellow by the name of Jack Minardi actually developed, he's working on something called SyncNet. Now it's based off of BitTorrent, Sync. It's sort of like a Dropbox software. We can put a file into a software and it actually syncs with somebody else's machine and it can share your information, images and videos and files, whatever you want that way, which is pretty cool. He's actually going to try to build something based off of that, and it's going to be for web browsing. So people, someday we'll get to a point where it doesn't matter what type of block governments have, some people will be able to get across the censorship, which is pretty cool. Like all things, it can be used for good things and bad things, but I'm kind of excited about the idea of having a web browser that can't be censored. I think it's really important to have that information flowing all across the world. Okay, Japan, they're changing their tune about pacifism. It's in their constitution. Their interpretation is that, hey, we can't use intercontinental ballistic missiles or long-range strategic missiles or anything like that. We're trying to have a more defense-based system in our country. And now they're talking about, hey, we want to play a bigger role in defense. They're saying, hey, we want to play a more active role in defense. They're concerned about their disputes with China over islands. They're concerned about North Korea. Now they're changing their tune because that's after World War II, they were saying that we are a pacifist country. But now things are sort of changing. Speaking of changing, their stock market has actually been getting hammered. It's down 14% since December 30th. Okay, that's a pretty significant drop in a very small period of time. The U.S. stock market has had some struggles. Some people have been a little concerned about that. Here's the thing about the U.S. stock market. There's a huge disconnect between the market and the economic reality. The average person is getting poorer. The average person is losing their wealth. That's what's happening. The middle class is shrinking. There's a bigger gap between the rich and the poor. Well, the stock market, the more it's being propped up by the Federal Reserve, the more that disconnect becomes. And you sort of have a 1929 type of situation where, you know, the economy's down here and the stock market's way up here. Well, at some point, people are going to realize they're going to be forced to face the fact that, hey, there's a big disconnect here. And the market just, it can't be supported by economic reality. And that's when you have big downturns. I think that something like that is very likely to happen. Also, you know, when you look at polls, there's a recent poll, CNN, ORC, international poll, to say that 66% of Americans believe that the U.S. government should take steps to reduce income inequality. Well, what does that mean? We know how socialism really worked out. You know, we know how communism, all that stuff really worked out. What exactly are they saying here? Look, President Obama's talking about he wants to raise the minimum wage in this country. Well, what is that going to do? If you're making $8 an hour and it goes up to, or $7 or something, and it goes up to $10 an hour, what does that mean? The corporations are going to pass on the cost, the added cost, in which they're paying those minimum wage workers, and they're going to raise their prices. So everybody's going to be dealing with a little bit higher prices, and the same people going from $8 to $10, they're going to be dealing with higher prices. So they're going to get more dollars from their employer, But they're gonna have to come up with more dollars to pay their basic bills. So you're not really helping them. The problem is that we're ignoring the core problems. Production in this country. We have a lack of production in this country. The production has been moved out of this country. The U.S. government has been encouraging corporations, allowing them to move jobs out of the U.S. and bring them into other countries, having other people make the products, then bring them back to the U.S. to sell it to us. Well, okay. How does that help the American people? Don't you see how that's a core problem? Until we address issues like that, until we address issues of the Federal Reserve devaluing the currency and encouraging the federal government to continue to run up more and more debt, we're going to continue to see the middle class erode. We're going to continue to see a bigger gap between the rich and the poor, especially when you have bailouts for certain corporations and entities in our society. While you force the taxpayers to pay for it. So yeah, you're seeing a bigger gap between the rich and the poor. There's, as far as the U.S. economy, there's talk of the service sector growing slightly according to the ISM, non-manufacturing index. It went from 53 in December on an index to 54 in January. Anything above 50 is some type of growth, but those are pathetic numbers. 53 to 54, when 50 is considered to be neutral and anything above it is growth, that's pretty pathetic. That's pretty pathetic numbers right there. When you look at the actual ISM manufacturing index, it tells you a pretty pathetic story. It's actually going down. It was actually a 5.2 percentage point drop in the index. It went down to somewhere around 51.3, 51.2 for the actual manufacturing index recently in January. This not good. Not good at all. Come on. You know, it's yeah, also, new orders dropped, what, over 13 percentage points? 13 percentage points. 13 percentage points in January. Pretty incredible, all right? But ADP saying that, hey, we created 175,000 new jobs. Okay, last month. ADP, how many of those jobs were actually paying a living wage? You know, it's like, how many of those jobs were actually full-time? You know, questions like that really need to be raised about these statistics. You know, it's like the unemployment number. Oh, it's down to 6.7%. Well, okay. How come I don't see that reality around here? I'm looking at Flint as an economic dead zone, for crying out loud. All right, last but certainly not least, straw purchases. There was a former police officer who got into trouble for buying a gun for his uncle. Now, at one point, they thought the gun was involved in the robbery, but there was no arrest. The guy is actually going to take this to the Supreme Court. And the problem is that he signed on the form, because every time you buy a gun in a store, you gotta fill out some paperwork. And one of the questions is, are you the actual buyer, the transferee of the actual firearm? And he wrote yes, but in reality, he was actually buying it for his uncle. Turns out, his uncle was able to legally own a firearm. But because he answered yes, he got into trouble because of that. Well, he's challenging this. He's saying that the federal government is wrong and basically treating him like a criminal because he bought a gun for his uncle, even though they both can legally own firearms. Now, do I think he should be able to buy a gun for someone who can legally own a firearm? I don't have a problem with that, although I understand the federal government definitely has a problem with that. The issue is, what do you think? Do you think something like that should be banned? Do you think the Supreme Court should come down against him or for him? Now, here's the thing. He wasn't buying the gun for somebody who was a felon who legally couldn't own a firearm. So I don't see the problem with a person who can legally own firearms buying a gun for another person who can legally own firearms. A lot of people are sort of concerned about maybe the government tracking them down or putting them on some type of list. That's a concern that a lot of people have when they try to buy guns at the stores. So I understand that concern. And what do you think about the background program that we currently have? A lot of people are convinced that there is no background checker program. And extended background checks, we're gonna give us background checks. We already have background checks. I've been through a ton of background checks. And by the way, criminals are still gonna get guns even if you do extend background checks to private sales. Because, you know, you're basically saying that, okay, if person A is gonna sell a gun to person B, they're gonna have to go through a background check. Well, what's stopping them from saying, the hell of the law, I'm gonna sell it to you anyway. Criminals selling guns out of criminals would never say, okay, before I sell you this gun, we gotta go through a background check or something like that. It doesn't make any sense. It's kind of stupid. But anyway, guys. All right, guys, thanks for watching, thanks for listening, and don't forget, the future belongs to those who prepare for it today. Bye.